Hello, I'm so glad that everyone can join. I see that people are starting to trickle in, so we're going to give everybody another minute. I see everyone is starting to join, so we're just going to give another minute before we get started. While we're waiting for everyone to join, if you wanted to take a look at the chat, that's where we're going to be posting some updates. It'll be open for others to add their questions, add their comments. We'll be keeping an eye on it. So definitely make yourself familiar with the chat. So because we only have, I believe, an hour together, I want to get started. First of all, welcome to this year's launch of the Gender Champions in Nuclear Policy Annual Report, Tested by Crisis. We are so pleased to be able to bring you this report, this discussion. 2020 was quite a year. And so I don't need to tell all of you that. So we're here today to tell you what we learned from our network, from the field, and also hear directly from a gender champion about what it was like on the other side of that experience. Before we get started, though, I just want to give a few thank yous. Thank you, first of all, to the team at NTI, in particular, Jack Brosnan and Mackenzie Cater, for all of your work this past year. To the fearless ambassador, Laura Holgate, who has really just been such a leader through this and kept us all together. I also want to thank the comms team at NTI and others who've supported it, including Maddie Berzik, Dee Chudari, the leadership team, Joan Rolfing, Secretary Moniz, Carmen McDougall, and to our champions, our 71 gender champions and their focal points who make up this network. And we are so pleased to be joined today by one of them, Nancy Parrish, who's just really, she's shared so much with us. We're really happy to bring her perspective to this panel. So in terms of the agenda, we're going to start with just a brief overview. We're going to hear directly from the champion, from the panelists, from Jack and from Nancy, before we go into questions. And we will leave time for your questions. So please make sure to drop them into the Q&A box. And so with that, let's get started. So the two people joining me today, Jack Brosnan, a program officer at NTI, and those who are familiar with the Gender Champions Network know that he is one of the people who makes the magic happen. And so he and Mackenzie really spent a lot of time on this report. And so we're excited to hear from him. Nancy Parrish is the Executive Director of Women's Action for New Directions. And so she'll be talking more about the experience of leading an organization during the pandemic. So with that, Jack, can you tell us more about your key findings from the report?
Thanks, Michelle. I would absolutely love to. But first, I'd like to just reiterate your thank you to all of the focal points who represent what makes our network powerful and effective. Without the folks who are doing this work every day, reporting data back to us, keeping gender champions accountable, and really just remaining dedicated champions in their own right for advancing gender equity, nothing that we do would be possible. And I'd also like to just again say thank you to my colleague and co-conspirator at NTI, Mackenzie Cater, who has had as much of a hand in all of this as I have. And without her, none of this would have been possible. So with that, I'll take you through some of the findings from our report. So one of the core tenets of being a gender champion is standing up for representation. In our professional community, appearing in expert fora is a really important form of professional currency. The ability to tap into a diverse section of voices to discuss critical issues in nuclear policy makes our community stronger. But it's long been a paradigm that these types of expert fora overrepresent male experts. And that's not to say that there aren't incredible women experts out there in the community to be brought in, accessed, and elevated in these fora. So every gender champion, as part of their commitment, pledges to avoid, whenever possible, speaking on all male panels of experts. It's what we call the panel parity pledge. It's a core commitment made by every one of our 71 gender champions. So our network grew appreciably between 2019 and 2020, growing from about 50 to over 70 organizations. And not every one of those champions reported data for inclusion in our 2020 annual report, but you will see that a number of them, due to the pandemic or other reasons, were unable to appear on public panels or to speak publicly. And as the network grew, we also came to include some champions who don't tend to speak publicly. So our sense of what representation looks like has changed a bit. But we are proud to say that despite challenging conditions, for a second year running, the number of champions who were unable to uphold the panel parity pledge, who did speak on all male panels, fell by a percentage point. So including the group who did not speak on panels, you'll see that most champions are upholding their commitment to representation of diverse voices and avoiding those all-male panels. But being a gender champion goes well beyond just that basic commitment to representation. There are unique actions taken by every champion as well. Each gender champion makes three or more unique commitments using a framework that we call SMARTY. So you may be familiar with the SMART framework. We use an adaptation of that. In this case, SMARTY stands for specific, measurable, ambitious, relevant, time-bound, inclusive, and equitable. Using that framework, each champion defines a commitment that represents action taken to create change and advance gender equity within their organization or their work. We don't report on the individual actions taken by gender champions publicly, but the focal points who support gender champions report back to us on an annual basis about the actions taken toward completing those commitments and the status of their completion. We're incredibly proud to say that during a really challenging time marked by the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, organizations adapting to remote and flexible work conditions and attempting to maintain continuity of operations. This is a second year running where gender champions are successful in completing over 60% of their commitments. What was unique this year was that we had a number of new organizations join the network after our data reporting cutoff, and they wanted to participate in the reporting process to get acclimated to our accountability structure and become stronger members of the network. So you'll see on the far right of the top right bar graph, there were 19 commitments that were in progress for less than 1 year, and that represents new members of the network. If you accept those commitments, our completion rate is 70% of unique commitments. And that includes things like ensuring that interns received compensation and time off, including diverse perspectives and curricula of graduate and professional programs, bringing diversity to boards of directors, redeveloping HR policies to be more inclusive, and perhaps most importantly during the pandemic, accounting for things like remote and flexible work that enabled people to spend time with family members, children, and continue doing their jobs during incredibly challenging times. Accountability is a core part of the Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy Framework, and we do now look beyond the completion of commitments and upholding the panel parity pledge. For the first time in our last data reporting cycle, we asked focal points about the composition of their organizations across the hierarchy, the gender balance at every level. This is an important metric of progress in advancing gender equity across the community because it enables us to look at progress made on bringing new talent into the community through professional pipelines, as well as retention and advancement. Tracking that balance in our network, it unveils important signs of progress, but also it illuminates some really critical challenges. So we see that at the staff level, the community has been incredibly successful in drawing in diverse new talent, but challenges remain in pursuing retention and advancement of talented professionals. The Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy Network almost undoubtedly overrepresents women in positions of leadership. So the one-to-one ratio of men to women in leadership positions is likely biased in favor of balance, where across the nuclear policy community, this is less likely to be true. Similarly, it's more likely that organizations in the Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy Network have women on their boards of directors. But even so, in a community or a network that is preferenced toward a greater or more equal gender balance, we still see those challenges in achieving parity, equity, and equality at higher levels. An additional strand of work undertaken by Gender Champions in Nuclear Policy in 2020 and early 2021 was to address the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic on our community. Taking into account a growing body of work that shows that the impacts of the pandemic have broken unevenly across lines of gender, we set out to explore what that looked like in the nuclear policy community. This began with the sense, as we were collecting data from focal points and gender champions, that the pandemic had dramatically affected their ability to maintain operations, to pursue their commitments to advance gender equity, and to support their employees. Our findings were striking, and they're available separately on the Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy website in full alongside our annual report. But what we'll talk about today is an important counterpart to the progress made by Gender Champions. One incredibly striking finding was that of the 231 people surveyed by Gender Champions, 66% were women. Among that group, those women were three times more likely than their male counterparts to have had their work hours reduced. And within that group of women whose work hours were reduced, 86% attributed that reduction to an increased burden of care work. Care work represents unpaid time spent on labor outside of the professional space. So that's things like caring for children, other household members, sick family members, other support for unpaid activities, or time spent in an informal economy. The time spent on care work is a direct obstacle to women's ability to participate and engage in the workforce, and it contributes directly to things like the finding of the previous slide, that retention and advancement to higher positions still remains challenging for women in the community. This is a key obstacle that already existed in the community, but has been exacerbated by COVID. But we also have good news to report. And that pertains directly to where the audience that we're with today, the panel we're with today, and the findings we're talking through today. And that is that principled leadership by Gender Champions matters immensely and makes a huge difference. And we have data to support that finding. When we surveyed 231 people, we asked whether their employer was part of the Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy Network. This allowed us to dig into our findings and see if outcomes were different between leaders who are gender champions and leaders who are not gender champions. We are pleased to say that among surveyed participants working for gender champions, outcomes were across the board broadly better. They were less likely to have been separated from employment, less likely to have seen work hour reductions, less likely to have seen pay cuts, less likely to have considered leaving the field, less concerned that the pandemic would negatively affect their professional development or advancement, more likely to have had access to professional development funds, to have had a regularly scheduled performance review, to have felt adequately supported by their employer, to have had access to remote work before the pandemic started, and to have had access to other remote or flexible work options. And additionally, more likely to have received a stipend from their employer for home office expenses. So when we talk about the types of commitments made by gender champions, the types of principled leadership that advance gender equity and make a difference in our community, these types of specific actions are the things that we're talking about. And we can see that they do make a concrete difference in the experience of people working in our community. That's something that we're incredibly proud of, and we are more than happy to see progress made during such a trying time. So for more details on what that type of leadership looks like, what it looks like philosophically, what it means on the ground, and how organizations run under that type of leadership, I'll pass the mic back to Michelle and Nancy for some further discussion.
Thank you, Jack. Nancy, we just saw a lot of data, a lot of numbers. What are the stories behind it? What's your experience been, and how does that information land with you? Does it resonate?
Yeah, thanks, Michelle, and thanks for that, Jack. It's really a testament, I think, to what you all have put into this as an effort to help support and educate those of us out here in the field on how to provide the kind of leadership that gets people through really difficult times, not to mention just day to day, when it's not tough. WAND is a little bit of an outlier in some of this. You know, when you look at the stats there, we are an all women organization with all women board. And I am, I think, in our field overall, probably a fairly atypical leader in that I didn't come to this work through the work and through the issues. I came to this through my interest in leadership, honestly. So this was, kind of the challenge of a lifetime for someone like me that I don't want to say I relished, because there was a lot that was really hard and really weird. But I do. I mean, I welcome the test, and it's a lot of pressure to be up here talking about how great we are. My staff, I'm sure, are watching this and are taking notes on, where I dropped the ball. But I come at leadership from a perspective of servant leadership. That is something, and it's kind of a heavy term. And if you go Googling, who are examples of servant leaders, they give you Mother Teresa and Abraham Lincoln and people like that. And so I think of it as more of an aspirational thing. It's a practice. It's a way I want to move in the world. And I definitely don't hit the mark all the time. But from my perspective, what that means is what comes first are the employees, the people of the organization. And I think that's a little bit different perspective sometimes than a lot of folks have in a lot of different spaces, not just this one. And so that is always my number one question is, what do they need? What do I need to do to make them safe and whole and comfortable and free them to be able to do their jobs effectively? That, obviously changed a lot in 2020. And I mean, I faced all the same questions, obviously, that everyone did of how do we work remotely and what do folks need now? And how do we provide that? The answers for my workforce was obviously different than others in terms of, we're relatively small. I had the ability really to do regular check-ins with every single person on a weekly basis to, that's honestly kind of how I started those conversations, how are you? What do you need? And really took my cues from my folks. It's not magic, I don't think. I think it's just sort of, it's literally putting them first. I want to comment too, I think in our space and honestly in any kind of particularly nonprofit space, there's a lot of reliance on passion and the love for the work and your personal commitment to it, which obviously is super important and what draws most people here. But I think that that sometimes can, from the employer perspective or the leader perspective, kind of skew and let us rely on, everyone's passionate about it, so they'll put up with this or put up with that. And I don't mean it in a malicious way, but I think instead, kind of really shifting focus for me and saying, this is a valuable resource that I have here, this person, every single one of them. And so what do I need to do to provide for the care and the feeding of that particular person, so they are free to live that passion out and that I'm not squelching that passion by making it harder for them to be here. So I don't know if that answers your question a little bit.
It does. And I have one follow-up question. You mentioned your staff, and I know one of the things that we have talked about pretty frequently in the network of how do you mitigate that power dynamic or that differential between senior leadership and staff leadership to really get a sense of what's going on. And I know for me, I learned a lot about my colleagues this last year that I don't think they probably ever intended to share with their colleagues or supervisors or things like that. And so did you have any learnings about when it came to that, or how to provide help when maybe it's not the staff's instinct to ask for it?
Yeah, it's a lot of listening. And I think one of the learnings that, I have interacting with different staff people, boy, I hope this doesn't sound terrible, but it's a lot like parenting. You parent different children differently. Fair is not equal. And so it's learning to listen that, like, okay, when Michelle says she's fine, but I can just hear that thing in her voice, I know she's not really fine. Whereas Jack might say to me, here's what I need. I need A, B, C, D. And so there's just different ways that they engage. And so I think it's learning to relate to your employees. And again, I have the luxury of a relatively small organization, so I really do get to know everybody individually. I also know there's some, particularly, when I'm talking, intern level or whatever, that are never going to say it to me. There's no way I can make that door open, but I know that they will talk to someone else. So not in a sneaking around or backdoor way, but I can kind of hear from someone else, so-and-so is really struggling with this. Honestly, it's just listening and paying really close attention.
Thanks for that. So let's shift into, now that I've already opened the door and I'm asking questions, Jack, how was this year different from all other years? What surprised you about what you found from the data?
Well, up front, I think the answer's the obvious one, but it's also the one that nobody wants to hear, right? There was a pandemic. And that's different. It changes everything. And it definitely affected all of our gender champions, all of the focal points, everyone working for them, and everyone in our community, everyone in the world, right? But at the same time, what was different about that was that, and what surprised me, frankly, was that we weren't knocked off course, right? We saw that our goal setting approach, year one was proof that the formula works. You set a target, you track progress on it, and you come back and you tell us what you did, and you're more likely to get that done than if you just say, yes, I care about gender equity, I care about diversity, I'm going to do something. But the pandemic was a true existential threat that disrupted every part of the world. And somehow in all of that noise, gender champions, focal points, their organizations kept putting one foot in front of the other, and they were on par with the year previous in doing that same work. And alongside that, I think what makes that even more surprising is that in that second year of reporting, we saw so many people making more ambitious commitments. They swung for the fences in year one, and then they came back and said, no, I'm ready for more. And we saw folks taking on multi-year commitments, taking on really big goals like reorganizing their board of directors, rewriting board bylaws to create term limits to ensure that you get diverse perspectives at a level of leadership that really makes a difference in the strategic direction, operations, and culture of an organization. And that, to me, was really an important bright spot in a year that was incredibly challenging for our community and incredibly challenging for everyone.
So I'm going to push you on this because accountability is a key part of our network. We've talked a lot about the upsides. What are the concerns that you're hearing or the challenges that you're seeing that are facing the champions and focal points of the network?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think, you know, again, it's probably the stuff that nobody wants to hear because it's more about the pandemic. And a lot of that is that it's so much harder to connect with people remotely. There are things you can do. And I think Nancy has given us some really good clues about the personality management and the heart that goes into the kind of leadership that can get around the challenges of the pandemic. But we've seen a number of organizations expand their staff, or we've seen turnover in key positions. And it is incredibly challenging to build a new team culture in a remote environment when folks are coming and going, you don't have the benefit of in-person contact, and it's much more challenging to build that kind of rapport. In the same sense, you know, a lot of work around equity, diversity, and inclusion, belonging, accessibility is very personal work on some level. You know, there are principles and best practices that undergird it, but it means something to everyone on a very personal level. And those can be incredibly challenging conversations to dig into in that meaningful way when you don't have the benefit of in-person contact and things like exactly what Nancy was talking about, the tone of someone's voice, the finer shades of meaning that you get from a person's affectation and the way they present themselves in a conversation, whether they're hesitant to engage. You don't know if it's Zoom fatigue setting in or if it's a conversation they're not comfortable having. And I think folks are really hungry for answers around that kind of stuff. And you know, that's one of our strengths, right? Is we have this incredible network of really dedicated, hardworking people who are willing to share lessons that they've learned from trying things, from working within their teams to find out what works and what doesn't. And road-tested solutions have become kind of the byline of Gender Champions. That's what we have to offer folks in some ways. But the hard part is that a lot of these questions remain unanswered. Some things don't have great answers yet. And we're also waiting for the other shoe to drop in a lot of ways. We're 2 years into a pandemic and still going. Many of us are not in our offices, including among the three of us. You see different situations there. So I think the uncertainty is maybe the greatest challenge of all.
Nancy, speaking of this new, I mean, first of all, if there's anything you'd like to add to that, you absolutely should. But I'm also really curious to hear from you how you are seeing this next phase of the pandemic and how you're navigating it.
Big sigh. It's going to be interesting. Welcome to my office closet. I have over time decorated it. I honestly don't know. And the question comes up a lot, you know, my staff are like, so we're going to go back. And, you know, because I know all the arguments, the kind of for and against, and, you know, what that could look like. And I don't even pretend to have the answers on that. I do, once again, I come back around to, I have my response to my staff. I don't know. Do you want to, do we need to, does it, you know, is that a thing folks need? Because that's, to me, that's the number one issue. We've already proven we can do all this remotely. Like, done. We did it. We're doing it. And so to me is, I'm looking to, you know, to the staff and to the work of, is there a compelling reason for us to do it differently? And right now, we haven't seen it. But I don't, you know, so is this forever? Are we always going to work like this? I don't know.
So, you know, shifting gears just a little bit, the pandemic wasn't the only thing that happened in 2020. We also saw a huge outpouring of action and grief and movement following the murders of George Floyd and others. Jack, did you see anything in the data or have you heard anything through the network? Like, what has the impact of that been and how are you seeing organizations respond?
Yeah, we absolutely did. And, on a personal note, it was heartening to see that because there are segments of our community that are well ahead of the eight ball in recognizing racial justice is an important component of the work that we do. There are folks who are addressing the disproportionate impact of the nuclear enterprise on Indigenous communities, things along those lines. But in 2020, a lot of organizations stepped forward to say in a very concrete way that they cared about racial justice and made it part of the culture of their organizations. And one of the ways we saw that was just an initial exchange within our network of statements about the importance of the time that we were living through and the need for organizations to express solidarity for a mission built around racial justice. But I think perhaps most importantly in our community, we saw the growth of organizations in solidarity, which is a network of its own built around the concept of advancing racial justice with its own concrete goals tied to it. And we were incredibly proud to see how many members of our network were initial signatories of Orgs in Solidarity's solidarity statement. And it led us to a bit of a fork in the road in our work. We prioritize a broad sense of the importance of diversity, equity, and inclusion in all that we do. But at the end of the day, our initiative, our project is gender champions in nuclear policy. And we recognize that there are limits to what we can do, what we're equipped to do, and the work that we've cut out for ourselves. So it led us to a choice ultimately to say that gender champions in nuclear policy is a gender equity initiative. And we are not best equipped to pursue all aspects of diversity. But what we do have is this great accountability framework. And organizations are waking up to the need to address these other dimensions of diversity in their work. So we've encouraged folks through their unique SMARTY commitments to address other forms of diversity of all types. And they've really been quite ambitious in doing so. And that's been incredible to see. And it's been our great pleasure to work alongside organizations like Women of Color Advancing Peace, Security, and Conflict Transformation, Organizations in Solidarity, out in NATSEC, and others who address other aspects of diversity in their own ways, more specifically than we're capable of doing, but are incredible partners, incredible allies, and together are really taking the national security community at large in a much needed direction, opening incredibly important conversations.
Nancy, I know WAND has this fabulous program in Voz Alta, so I know this has also been a discussion for you all. How has that impacted your work?
You know, it's really kind of core to our work, because obviously when you're talking gender champions, it's really easy for us to check all the boxes and we win. But the work for WAND has been exactly that, is being more inclusive to all women. So not just affluent women who made their way to Washington, D.C., general metropolitan area in some way, shape or form, which yay to those ladies too. But I think that's been our focus, is both as an organization and then in our work to be reflective and respectful and inclusive of a lot of women's experiences. So you mentioned the En Voz Alta. That is a core program that is one my staff dreamed up. By staff, let me just say it. It's Corey Greer's baby, which is expertly led these days by Andrea Pimentel, who is on our staff as well. They have just knocked it out of the park, and it was literally just an idea. And we sought some funding for it originally that we were not successful in getting. And then we just decided, screw it, we're doing it anyway. This is too important. So it's really blossomed. And just, you know, short story, it is our effort to help early in their career and or still in college, young Latina women into our space. And by doing a mentor-mentee setup, Michelle, you have served as a mentor. I know you've had a really positive experience with this. Welcoming folks into the space and helping them build those networks that are so key to doing a darn thing in this town, as we all know. I'll tell you, one of the huge bonuses for that program was the pandemic. Because we went from what was really built as an in-person mentoring mentee kind of situation, where folks could get together and have coffee or talk or do whatever or shadow for a day, which meant by its very nature, it was already women that had made their way, you know, to the DMV area. When we went all remote, we were able to start working with women from around the country. And that is what is super exciting for us, is being able to invite women in that don't have a natural path to getting here on their own. So we're, you know, right now, Andrea's deep into recruiting for next year. Those of you listening, go be a mentor. It's an awesome experience. To help women that are in state schools around the country that have interest in this field and interest in our space. And yes, nuclear, but we work generally, it's peace and security writ large. Our mentors have just been awesome, awesome people who've been so generous with their time and energy. And I, you know, the response we've had from the mentees has been fantastic. But I won't ramble too long on this because I could go all day on this program. It's really, really exciting for us. But that's kind of a, you know, from for us, it felt like this is a rubber hitting the road. This is where we can do something, you know, to your point, Jack, we can't do all the things, but here is something concrete that actually makes a difference in people's lives. So that's, I mean, that was something that, again, that, you know, I had staff that came forward with this awesome idea and was like, yeah, let's figure it out. Let's do it.
So I'm going to ask a couple more questions, but to the audience out there, I see that we already have a couple questions coming in. Please put them in. I'll be starting to incorporate those in just a minute. Jack, you know, we've been talking about specific efforts, programs. You've listed out, you know, concrete steps that people are, that organizations are taking to change. But what does it all mean? How does it add up? How do you get from the small to the big? Are you starting to see any changes there within organizations in the network?
Yeah, you know, I think so. And that takes a few forms. You know, part the first, I would say that the Gender Champions model of change is predicated on this idea of catalytic change, right? And part of that is our drive to grow our number of gender champions. So in 2 years, we've hit 71. We're always recruiting new gender champions. And part of that work is bringing them into the network, making them comfortable, feeling like they have the tools and the resources and the community behind them to support the work that they're doing, to build strong from a strong foundation. And that's what makes us kind of greater than the sum of our parts. So I will give you an anecdote. An unnamed source who Ambassador Holgate and I offered a briefing on some gender champions activities to said that it's becoming clearer and clearer either you are or you aren't a gender champion if you're a head of an organization in the nuclear policy community. And that is exactly the kind of change we want to see, because as those numbers grow, as the peer pressure grows, as the sense that this is what good leaders do, this is how you show principled leadership of exactly the kind that Nancy is talking about and the kind that Nancy shows every day as the leader of WAND, that is a clear commitment to your community, to your staff, to yourself, to your values. And that is catalytic change in a way. But in addition to that, it happens at a smaller level, right? As organizations come into the network, part of that building strong from a strong foundation is the commitments that they make themselves. So when someone sets out to become a gender champion, we'll offer some guidance. We have some draft pledges that were designed alongside the Gender Champions Initiative itself that are meant to be instructive, built on best practices, and often helpful, representing a few different common workflows or types of work in our community that can be really powerful and impactful. And often, gender champions in their first outing will tap into some of those commitments. But as they become familiar with how our system works, the benefits of the accountability and the reporting structure, it gives them time to think about, what am I really trying to do here? What does my organization need? And one really impressive development has been an entirely organic one. You know, in the first year, we saw a lot of gender champions sitting down solo at their desk and saying, okay, here are three things that we're going to do. And there wasn't necessarily a really strong connection within the organization to the leader being a gender champion and what those commitments were. But through a natural evolution, a best practice that was developed within the community and propagated among gender champions themselves, we see increasingly these folks having full-on internal conversations at all levels of staff to say, I am a gender champion and I'm developing new commitments toward diversity, equity, and inclusion, or toward gender equity as part of this initiative. What do you think we should do? Or here's what I propose. Do these sound like good things to you? Getting honest to God feedback from their staff, getting buy-in at all levels, hearing what's important to people. And that scales up in an incredibly powerful way because it makes everyone in the organization a stakeholder in the change that happens. And it ensures an inclusive process where voices are heard, because leaders are in an incredible position to use their leverage, but also they can't have eyes in every corner of their organization. There are going to be perspectives and experiences that are not as familiar to them, but are incredibly important in thinking about what needs to change. And I am so proud of the evolution we've seen there.
Nancy, I know you said that Wand is somewhat of an outlier in the network. How does that resonate?
It's dead on. I mean, I think it's true. I literally early on, you know, when you and I were talking about this, Michelle, I think we were part of the original core group. It was like, well, yeah, of course we'll sign on, but like, I don't know what goals to make because we're all ladies. Like, what are we supposed to do? You know, I mean, I was like, I don't really know how do I come up with things? And, you know, we now, Corey also serves as our focal point now. And has gotten very, very involved. And exactly what Jack says, I mean, we have some really deep conversations about, you know, what is it that we're trying to achieve now? What is it? What are some good stretch goals for us to put in? And as I said, you know, for us, that tends to be more around equity. But, you know, it has definitely been an evolution to kind of come to that place of like, oh yeah, no, we got a lot of things we need to work on. So it still is a challenge for us. And I appreciate that challenge. I want to be challenged in that way.
So now I'm going to start opening up to audience questions. We have one from Lisa that you might've seen in the chat. Team, I really appreciate all you're doing for gender equity. I note that you haven't yet tackled the Department of Defense in seeking new members willing to commit to gender champions goals. Is there an intent or plan to do so? I have found in the past year, we've seen an upsurge in interest for actionable programs like this, and potentially it's a good time to try. Jack, what are the recruitment plans for gender champions?
Well, I will say in the first place, when we say nuclear policy, we mean that in the biggest tent sense possible. If you look at the composition of our network now, we have organizations like WAND, and you heard, you know, Nancy in her own words, nuclear is a small part of their mission in the peace and security space. But we also have nuclear energy companies now. We have organizations with small nuclear subunits. Essentially, if your mission includes anything nuclear at all, whether it be arms control, energy, non-proliferation, really anything. We have some grassroots folks who work on health impacts of nuclear testing, all kinds of things. You are more than welcome in our network. The price for entry is $0 and tickets are easy to come by. I'll put it that way. In terms of our plans for expansion, we are actively and continuously trying to grow this network in every possible direction. It's our sense that there are some communities that it's a little harder to find your way into. The technical community was tough to get into at first, and what's been most powerful for us has been leveraging the connections of members of our network who become gender champions and say, hey, I know this person who could also become a gender champion. And that's what's led us into the national labs, the nuclear energy sector, media outlets, some academic institutions, some really fascinating directions. Government is not at all off the table for us. The challenge has really been twofold, I would say. First would be determining the proper organizational unit within an entity like the US government. Who becomes a gender champion? Do we ask President Biden to become a gender champion? Probably not. But someone out there in some division of the US government is well equipped and ready to be a gender champion. And it is my great hope that we will find them and we will onboard them. Aside from that, bureaucracy is always something that needs to be worked through. You know, every organization has its own bureaucratic culture and bureaucratic processes. And it's important that becoming a gender champion happens in the right way. And what's the right way? It's what works for an organization. Some small, very nimble organizations can become gender champions within 2 days. Larger organizations, it's really important that you secure approvals and talk to everyone and ensure buy-in everywhere, because you want an organization to be all in if they're in. We don't do box checking. We don't do tokenism. We don't do half-hearted efforts. Gender champions is honest to God, as Nancy said, where the rubber meets the road, we do things. So we want it to happen right. So the door is open to government. It absolutely is. It's just a question of how we step through.
Nancy, you know, following up on that with, you know, what you've seen the network evolve as you were, you know, we were a part of that core group initially testing out what it might be. What are you excited about, or what do you hope we keep as the network continues to expand?
Maybe I'm repeating myself a little bit, but again, to me, it's about embracing the diversity of women. I do think in many sectors in this town, and probably obviously in lots and lots of places, it is pretty easy to teeter into just a certain kind of woman. And again, in this town, that tends to be more affluent, white, well-educated women who've come to this kind of work. And once again, hooray for those women. But I think it's being, it's inviting in and welcoming in. And that takes some real core work, because, you know, it's one thing, I think, to just sort of say, yeah, we want all the ladies, but it's making the kind of environment in your organization and in our space writ large that truly is welcoming and inclusive. And so that takes a real shift in how you approach things. That takes a lot of listening, I think, to the folks as they come in, that they're, you know, not having someone be just a token at the table or whatever, but like genuinely wanting their input, their advice, their perspective on things. You know, I think that's one of the huge things. We in this space talk a lot about the importance of having women at the table. And I think it's really important to have all kinds of women at the table who live really different experiences. I'll tell you, I mean, one of the things that I get such an absolute blast out of is like the interns we get. You know, we get some just amazing, and typically I try really hard to have our interns be people that are not, again, kind of straight in the DC area, that are coming from the outside world. And it's just so, to me, it's really useful to hear that perspective, to hear their, you know, when one of the challenges, and this is one we deal with all the time, is kind of, you know, how do we make this kind of work relevant to folks out in the States? And so what's really useful is getting people who are from out in the States to tell us what, you know, what resonates and what doesn't with them. So I think that's it, is really making sure we're having as broad engagement as possible.
We actually have a question also related to this, so I'm going to ask you to expand on it. Is there a difference that you saw or are seeing between more established staff and people earlier in their careers? We've had some systemic problems in keeping younger people in the field. So do you think that this, I'm assuming they mean the pandemic, has made things worse or better?
Yes. It's made some things worse and some things better. Again, speaking from our organization, we generally have, you know, we skew younger. I find myself very often alone as a mid-50s woman, not bitching and moaning about, oh, kids today. And, cause that's not my experience of it. I cannot tell you, regardless of how they've come to the organization, there's just not one single person that I've had the pleasure of working with at WAND that doesn't come with so much to offer. And so, I mean, I don't know, I'm not answering the question really, really well. I think it is, once again, I think it's on us as leaders to create an environment that people want to come to. I just don't know that I have a more important job than that. You know, when you want, I want to attract and retain really talented people, and I want them really happy. And we don't have the luxury of saying, well, let me pay you gazillions of dollars, so I have to, you know, resort to other things. What can I do? What does make this a place you want to be? Once again, we're a small organization. There's not a huge career ladder, so I don't expect anyone that comes with us to stay, you know, for years on end, because there's not a lot of growth there. But I love being part of that too. I think it's impinging upon us. One other little piece about what I think is important from a leadership perspective is when I'm talking with my staff, like, I know that this isn't the only job you're ever going to have. I'm really interested in where it is you want to go and how can I facilitate, you know, getting you where you're headed. And I want you to be happy the time that you're with us, but I also want to help you get where you're really, really going. Even if that's outside of obviously our organization, potentially our space.
Really, really well said. Jack, what did you see in the survey about it?
Well, I think we saw, you know, to foot stomp what Nancy just said, we saw good and we saw bad. You know, on the one hand, it became clear as Mackenzie and I were conducting the research and digging through our findings that the nuclear policy community is a little different, right? We didn't see hugely rampant job loss or some of the other really dramatic and shocking economic impacts that we're seeing across the United States and across the world in some ways. But what we did see was these really insidious signs of symptoms that need to be monitored very carefully. Things like that increased burden of care work, things like loss of access to professional development funds, things that challenge the already inequitable structures that prevent women and, frankly, members of other groups from fully engaging with their professional community, from accessing opportunities. And that bears thinking about, because what we need to do is keep an eye on those things and ensure that 5 years down the road, we haven't started unraveling something that takes us in a direction that gets much, much, much worse, where all of this work has been done to attract diverse talent to our professional community. And we find out that it hasn't been a good experience for them to enter this community, and they haven't wanted to stay in the community because of a lack of opportunity, because of obstacles preventing them from accessing great opportunities for advancement that are available to other people. And there is a lot in that survey. So I will say, you know, to the audience, to anyone interested, you can find the full set of findings on the Gender Champions in Nuclear Policy website. But if you'd like to be briefed on or discuss that survey, please do get in touch. You can find my contact information on the NTI website. You can tweet us. You can submit the contact form on the Gender Champions website. Please do let us know. But what I will say, one positive thing that we've heard and that we've seen within the network is that folks are aware that this presents an opportunity for us to all think more creatively, as clearly Nancy has done, to think in depth. What do people need? What creates those opportunities? What makes them accessible? How can we be more creative in reaching out to people, in retaining them? What do they need? What can we change? There is a great opportunity for the advancement of equity as we return and recover from a pandemic, as folks are coming back to offices, as operations are flexing back to a quote unquote new normal. Part of that conversation needs to be, how do we apply an equity lens to this? How do we use this opportunity to change our community, to address the wrongs of the past and build back in a stronger, more effective, more diverse, more equitable way? Because it can be done, but like all of these things, it requires a specific vision and it requires hard work.
Yes. Yes, all of that. And I'm going to take you one step back on this. We have a question about what the research showed. And I think your solutions on what we actually need to do are spot on. But there's some curiosity, I think, about what the state of the field is. Did the research show anything about burnout? And do either of you see or have experiences with managing staff burnout, given that we are so far into the pandemic and, you know, the crisis, we are not out of crisis thinking. So, you know, Jack, maybe you can start. What are you seeing in that area?
Yeah, so we have some very concrete findings on this. Frankly, you know, we collected both quantitative and qualitative data and some really detailed anecdotes. And there will be more work coming on that in the future. We're incredibly proud of a partnership with Bombshell Toe Policy and Arts Collective that will be built around some of those personal stories that people were brave and generous enough to share with us about what it was like working and living through the pandemic in our community in early 2020, 2021, and beyond. But what the quant shows is that 1 in 10 folks mentioned burnout or some kind of mental health strain as the hardest thing that they were dealing with in the first quarter of 2021. And, you know, our sample size, 231 people, it's not enormous, but it's enough to know that that's significant. You know, the challenge is, it's hard to say how big the nuclear policy community is, but anecdotally, if you talk to your colleagues, your coworkers, your friends in the community, how many people do you know who are suffering from burnout? And we don't have great solutions for that. You know, At NTI, I'm fortunate enough to work for Ambassador Holgate, who is an incredible, incredible boss who subscribes to a similar form of leadership to what Nancy has described. And she has been an amazing shepherd of our team during this time. But even with such careful and principled leadership, folks are burnt out, are burning out, are tired. And you know, our work output across the community has stayed high, high quality, high volume at all times. But we don't have a great answer to, you know, how do you give people that break? How do you refresh their brains when there is no real time off anymore? I'm sure Nancy has a totally different and perhaps more important perspective as a leader of people.
No, I mean, I'm with you. I mean, it is a struggle. You know, what'd you say, 1 in 10 have dealt with mental health? I would argue 10 in 10 have at some point along the way. I have. I mean, there is that weird time. I mean, I know I'll just personally, well, like, okay, I can take whatever time I want, right? But when you live in this world, you're like, well, I'm already in my house. So, and I can't really go anywhere. So I'm going to take time off and do what? Watch more TV? It was really hard, I think, to find a way, and still is sometimes. I mean, the world's opening up a little bit. We've got a little bit more mobility these days, but I think it became really, really challenging to how do I unplug when I live here, I work here, I sleep here, I eat here, I watch TV here, you know, and how do I disconnect and just, you know, not open the laptop for a while? I don't have an answer to that, but it's been a huge challenge for everybody. And I think that's also, I know, you know, every one of us, certainly every single person on my staff, either personally or through their family, we've all dealt with stuff too. You know, things going on with kids or parents or your own health or, you know, and that's a lot. And it's a whole burden that, you know, obviously we can't solve for people or can't answer for them, but it's, you know, trying to create the space for people to be able to do that. But I commiserate. I don't have the answers on all of that.
So I'm going to use this moment. We have 5 minutes left. So final call for any questions. Jack, we have one. Do you all have plans to provide training to the broader community about DEI and effective management?
So that's a really tricky question, right? What DEI and effective management mean for a given organization can be subjective. You know, again, this is an area where there are best practices, but the work has to be done within an organization. It's incredibly important that folks seek out the right source of training for their organization and find a good fit for them. And that's really challenging because that's a commitment of time and a commitment of money, but it is incredibly valuable. So I don't know that Gender Champions and Nuclear Policy is necessarily equipped to provide public training, but we can certainly help folks figure out what they should be looking for, what's helpful, what's been helpful to other people. And within the network, we've certainly had exchange discussions about what's been good for me may not be good for you, but things like equity audits or training topics or what training to apply before hosting a large conference, things like that. You know, context is incredibly important. And that's something that should definitely be considered. But I will say another thing that we're quite proud to announce is a little different, but we are undertaking to address some of the findings of our survey, one of which was that women were about 3 times as likely to have lost access to professional development funds or resources than their male counterparts. We will be launching shortly a partnership with Rethink Media to offer fully paid training opportunities for a cohort of 30 women in the nuclear policy community. So stay tuned for an announcement from us on that, but there will be an opportunity open to the community at large. We'll be soliciting applications. We'll select a random sample of 30 folks, and we are doing what we can. And we hope to see other folks step up to the plate and take a swing to do what they can as well. But training for an organization itself has to start from inside.
Thanks, Jack. So before we close, I want to ask each of you, we've talked a lot about a lot of really heavy and challenging things today. What are you most proud of that you have either accomplished or witnessed or been a part of this last year when it came to equity work?
Well, I'll go, and I'm always like super corny about this. I'll try not to get teary-eyed. It's my staff. They're so awesome. They're so smart. They're so brilliant. They do such incredible work. I mean, my job is to hire great people, give them everything in the world they need, and then get the hell out of their way so that they can do what they want to do. And they do it so well. I mean, I could give 100 examples. I am going to touch one more time, since Corey did put it in the chat. We really welcome participants in our En Voz Alta. Corey's put the link in there to that program. I welcome any of you to get in and participate in that. So that's, I'm corny. It's my staff. They're really awesome.
How about you, Jack?
You know, I would say that, and mine's kind of corny as well. So you're in good company, Nancy. It was, our first gender champions meeting during the pandemic. So typically we'll host quarterly meetings of members of the network for updates on regular business, talking about pressing issues, keeping folks apprised of what's going on, people coming and leaving the network, all those kind of important things. But in a really challenging time, so, you know, our first quarterly meeting during the pandemic was already a ways into the pandemic. Things had already kicked off and people were getting sick, people were getting ill all over the world, people were dying, and people were scared, frankly. But the strength within that network to recognize the diversity of experience that this pandemic surfaced, right? Leaders who have junior staff living in studio and one bedroom apartments, in shared homes with, you know, four, five, six roommates, folks moving back home to take care of elderly and ill family members, people with underlying conditions or immunocompromisations who were living in absolute fear day to day. And just the immediate care and thought that went into that. Sometimes your professional community can be a little bit of a depersonalizing place. We spend a lot of time promoting the work that we're doing, talking about how great we all are, you know, how all of our organizations are top of the pack, pioneering, doing cutting edge work. But there's something incredibly powerful in that humanizing moment of seeing who the people around you are and how they think about themselves and each other and how those pieces fit together. And for me, that's frankly, one of the things that gave me confidence that we would move forward through this pandemic and during it, gave us some great ideas of what we could do to try to be helpful, but also it just helped me kind of get through, you know, gave me some confidence to maintain course, to keep going. And I can't thank everyone in the network enough for that.
So we are now at 1 minute past our end time. I can't close it out better than either of you just did. So I'm going to say thank you. Thank you to our participants. Thank you to our network. And please check out the report. We're looking forward to the next year of work.